Today we're talking about the constitutionality of firing Robert Mueller, one of the few people trying to stay employed in the Trump administration. Some people think President Trump is considering firing Mueller because, frankly, I think he's tired of having people quit on him. Today we're looking back to 1783 to see what the founders of our country thought about all of this. But then again, that was the same year that the Russian Empire annexed Crimea. So, I guess not that much has changed.
Jubilation in Crimea as word came that Russian President Vladimir Putin in Moscow had signed a treaty that will incorporate the Ukrainian province into Russia.
That might be about the only thing that's similar, though. Because most of the mundane details of our lives would have blown Thomas Jefferson's mind. So, you're telling me everything you own is from the Orient? That said, over the centuries, the Supreme Court has managed to scrape together a definition of what a special counsel is, and what they can do. From the first time a special counsel was hired in 1875 by Ulysses S. Grant. And that special counsel did such a good job investigating, he also became the first special counsel to be fired by the president that same year. That said, it's President Grant, so just be glad he stayed above ground. We also saw special counsel appointed by President Garfield, a president most famous for sharing the name with a cartoon cat, Teddy Roosevelt, President Coolidge, President Truman, President Nixon, and President Reagan, while attorney generals appointed special counsels in the cases of Clinton and Bush. Wow, I hate to say it guys, but the special counsel might not be as special as we thought. So clearly with all these examples, things were bound to evolve. Because back in President Grant's day, you probably wouldn't have heard
fire Bob Mueller. I'll just tell you, this could precipitate a constitutional crisis.
The potential to provoke a constitutional crisis.
I think it will be a true constitutional crisis.
A constitutional crisis? Who will save us? It's a bird, it's a plane, it's the Justice League! Except people actually want to see more from this Justice League. So, Justice League, what do we do? Well, it turns out that we're not 100% sure yet, with both sides able to cite their own pieces of the Constitution and history to justify what they want to do to the special counsel. So, I'm here today to wade through the arguments and see where the dice land. First though, what is a special counsel? I mean, it's kind of hard to discuss firing someone when you're not sure who their boss is. I can't call up Jeff Bezos and demand he fire the manager of my local Burger King. Well, the modern framework for a special counsel was set up after the Watergate investigation, a scandal so egregious that Congress actually patched up the loopholes he had taken advantage of with the Ethics in Government Act. Which, wow, alright, can you imagine being the one voting against ethics in government? So, what did Richard Nixon do that was so bad it required legislating ethics back into government?
President Richard Nixon that day was trying to get rid of the special prosecutor investigating the Watergate scandal. His attorney general, Elliot Richardson, refused to carry out the order and resigned. Richardson's deputy, William Ruckelshaus, who immediately became acting attorney general, also refused, and he followed Richardson out the door. In the end, President Nixon succeeded in getting the special prosecutor discharged, but the Nixon presidency only lasted another 10 months.
So this Ethics in Government Act established firm rules for the appointment of a special counsel, whereas beforehand, I guess we were just kind of winging it. Alright, so this Ethics in Government Act passed, and one piece of it, Title VI, is extremely relevant to today, despite the fact that this portion wasn't renewed in 1999. It says that the special prosecutor can only be removed by impeachment and conviction by Congress, or by the Attorney General for substantial improprieties or a physical or mental condition that affects performance. Alright, so all of that sounds about as impactful as a debate over 1% or 2% milk is better. And it might have stayed that way if it didn't open the floodgates for a major Supreme Court decision that's caused a massive schism between liberals and conservatives over what they think the rights of the executive branch are when it comes to discussing special counsels. That's right, we're talking about the 1988 case of Morris versus Olson.
We'll hear arguments now in number 87-1279, Alexia Morrison versus Theodore B. Olson.
The question in this case was whether you could empower the Attorney General to appoint and have sole removal power over a special counsel, or whether independent counsels investigating high-level civil servants could only be appointed by the President. Because what could go wrong when you leave the prosecution of high-level civil servants to the highest-level civil servant? Alright, so this case was long and confusing, so I'm going to base this off of the published decision because, for what we're talking about, that's actually more important than knowing how they got there. So, the first structural argument made against this act was, this violates the Appointments Clause. The problem here is that the appointment of the actual guy in charge of running the special counsel is left up to the Justice Department instead of the President, which leads to the reports like,
breaking headline, the White House blindsided tonight as the Department of Justice reveals that they will appoint a special counsel to now oversee the FBI investigation into Russian meddling and any possible collusion. Former FBI Director Robert Mueller will now lead the investigation.
Although, I'm sure Trump would have appointed the most qualified candidate to lead the special counsel. Maybe if Eric Trump was free. Now, and this probably is a huge blow to the ego of special counsels everywhere, the head of special counsels are referred to legally as inferior officers. Which, come on, you can't just call them second in command or something? This is a super important distinction though, because the appointment clause only applies to principal officers, which means that
the appointment clause specifically delegates to Congress authority to make a determination where inferior officers are concerned as to whether or not their appointment properly belongs in the President alone under the principal officer treatment requiring both President and Senate to participate or in the department heads or the courts of law.
Oh man, give me some Tums because that was hard to digest. Basically, according to the Appointment Clause, Congress can only dictate who can appoint a special prosecutor because he is an inferior officer. Hey, cheer up, buddy, you're not an inferior officer to me. In this case, they decided to give the right to designate the special prosecutor to the Justice Department, in a move that was found to be constitutional. So the next structural argument was, that act violated the separation of powers by interfering with the powers of the executive branch. Now, there are two points here, but the first one is ridiculously semantic, to the point where I don't even think a thesaurus will help you. The argument was that the Ethics in Government Act said that the Attorney General, a member of the executive branch, could only fire someone if he had a good cause. Where some people felt overstepped the authority of the President to fire special counsels because they were closing in on him? The one fun problem with this good cause standard was,
well, she can be removed for good cause, can she not?
She can not be removed, she can be removed for a kind of good cause. The problem with good cause is the question is what is good cause? And the legislative history.
But that wouldn't be, good cause would not include refusing to obey the order of the President.
Not according to the legislative history.
Well, sounds like we have a solid grasp on that one. Maybe a good cause is, we don't want the President to be impeached. Or, because the President said so and he can fire me. On the broader scale though, this was not found to be a violation of the separation of powers. And not because it was an almost meaningless combination of words, but because while not giving firing power to the President, it maintained the firing power of the Attorney General, which left power in the executive branch. On a wider level, this act was not found to violate the separation of powers because it didn't transfer power between branches. It just took power from the President and transferred it to the Attorney General. This decision was approved as 7-1 with Kennedy not voting and Scalia dissenting. Seriously, how long has Scalia been on this court? So what does this mean for Mueller? Well, this brings us to today. First, in the Russia investigation, Attorney General Jeff Sessions has recused himself, so supervision fell to Deputy Attorney General Rod Rosenstein, a man who might have put Trump under more legal scrutiny than Twitter and Lester Holt combined. There are currently two bills Congress is trying to pass to protect Mueller that are similar. Yet, some are calling into question their constitutionality. Currently, the Attorney General, or in this case, Deputy Attorney General, can still file over a special counsel for good cause, and believe me, I have the best causes. What these two bills do is try to make it so the Attorney General has to have oversight from a 3-judge panel in order to fire a special counsel. In the bill sponsored by Lindsey Graham and Cory Booker, the special counsel can only be fired if the Attorney General travels through a Kafkaesque labyrinth of bureaucracy, filing an action with the US District Court and relevant House and Senate committees. If you think that's too much, though, the bill sponsored by Thorne Tills and Chris Coons require the Attorney General to inform in writing the special counsel why they're being fired, and give the special counsel a chance to appeal in court. Although, when they say in writing, something tells me it's going to be a tweet at Bob Mueller, which would be great for his Twitter considering he only has one visible tweet. It's almost like he has an important job and doesn't get distracted. By the way, great profile picture. You look like John Kerry if he was capable of emoting. Anyways, these two bills are being questioned as to their constitutionality, because conservatives are saying these measures are infringing on the president's right to determine who can serve in the executive branch, and transforming some of that power to the judicial branch. But the drafters of the law are arguing that they drafted the laws to be consistent with the rulings of Morris v. Olson, and therefore, the bills are consistent with the Constitution. Until, of course, the Supreme Court overrules that ruling, which would only happen if they rule a certain way in the upcoming case of Lucia v. Securities and Exchange Commission, in which they'll hear oral arguments on April 23rd. Now, this case is less than a thinly veiled attempt to overrule parts of Morris v. Olson. At first, the Solicitor General actually asked the court to question whether requiring an agency to prove they have a good cause to fire an inferior officer is constitutional. Which, what? I didn't realize that there was a problem in our government where our leaders were just looking at their subordinates and muttering, "I really wish I could fire you, but I have absolutely no reasoning behind it." Furthermore, his case says Congress should not have the power to, in any way, limit the president from firing an inferior officer, aka Mueller, and even if they can, they should not limit people to the burden of having to find any logic behind firing those people. You bet I'll be covering that case when they publish the audio. But for now, thank you, and that's all I have to say about that. Hey YouTube, if you want to support independent journalism investigating the Supreme Court, subscribe to our YouTube channel for our weekly Supreme Court Saturday episodes. Subscribe now and you can still be in our first 100 subscribers. As always, leave me a comment if you have an important case you think I should research, and thank you for watching.